Good afternoon to all IEM and UEM family members. I'm sure that I am audible and visible, and alongside me is Dr. Shantanu Sharma. He's a professor and the head of the Department of Physiotherapy at the University of Engineering and Management, UEM Jaipur. And he will be talking. As you can understand, he's from physiotherapy, so he's having a complete medical background, and he is going to talk from his medical background point of view. He's going to talk about stroke. So, okay, it's an important topic. It's an important topic for all of us. So I will request Dr. Shantanu to take over from here kindly.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank our Chancellor, sir, Pro Vice Chancellor, sir, Vice Chancellor, sir, Dean, sir, Provost, sir, for giving me this opportunity to speak in front of you. Today I have taken a topic from neuro, that is stroke. There is a reason behind taking this topic. Is generally the stroke, in common terms, it is known as brain attack. As we all heard about heart attack, similar to that, we have attack in the brain known as brain attack, and there is not very much awareness about in the people for this brain attack. So in medical terms, stroke is known as cerebrovascular accident. The word cerebro here stands for brain, and it occurs due to vascular problem in the brain. So the word is cerebrovascular accident. Now coming to the contents of this topic, I will give introduction, then there will be definition, types, signs of stroke, symptoms, brief diagnosis, what are the investigations done, what is the treatment available, and what are the preventive measures we all can take to prevent stroke. Nowadays, from last 5 to 10 years, the stroke is increasing in young age also. Previously, we used to see stroke or paralytic attack in old age persons only. But now, since last 5 to 10 years, it is increasing in young age. So we all must have a general idea about stroke. Coming to the introduction, stroke is the second leading cause of death in the world. Approximately 8 lakh people have a stroke each year, about one every 40 seconds. So we all can see that it is a huge number, and many people suffer from brain stroke each year or brain attack. Strokes occur due to problems with blood supply to the brain. So either the blood supply is blocked in the brain, or a blood vessel within the brain ruptures or bursts open, causing the brain tissue to die. So in both the cases, whether the blood supply is blocked or whether the blood vessel is ruptured or burst open, the blood supply to the brain tissue is reduced or it is stopped. So the brain tissue dies due to lack of blood supply. It is a medical emergency, and treatment must be sought as quickly as possible. So for heart attack, we all know that if some person near to us is having heart attack, we can give CPR and all. But in brain attack, what we can do is we have to call the ambulance and shift the patient to medical emergency as early as possible. Coming to the definition, a stroke is defined as a clinical syndrome of rapid onset of cerebral deficit lasting more than 24 hours or leading to death with no apparent cause other than a vascular one. So brain dysfunctioning of brain will be there for more than 24 hours, and it will start rapidly, suddenly, and it can also lead to death with no apparent cause than a vascular one. The cause must be a blood vessel related to blood supply to the brain, then only it will be known as stroke. A stroke is a rapid loss of brain function due to disturbance in the blood supply. A stroke happens when blood supply to a part of the brain stops, and it is sometimes called as brain attack. So it is also known as brain attack, similar to heart attack, we all know. So in this diagram, we all can see in number one, it is showing that blood clot can form during atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation is the word for unusual rhythm of heartbeat where the contraction and relaxation of atrium, one of the chamber of the heart, upper chamber, it is not in rhythm. So if the blood clot or plaque is formed in the heart, from there it gets disrupted and it can flow in the blood vessels. It can flow through carotid artery, blood clot travels in the bloodstream. And then this clot, when it reaches the brain, the blood vessels in the brain are very thin and minute. So clot blocks an artery in the brain. So the blood will not travel ahead, and the brain tissue which is present ahead will not get the blood and it will die. So we will be having stroke. It is third most common cause of death after cancer and ischemic heart disease. It is most common cause of severe physical disability, because the person will be having paralysis of one side of the body. Here I want you all know that we have two cerebral hemispheres. Here in this diagram we all can see one and second, first and second. So our right side of brain controls the left half of the body, and left side of the brain controls the right half. There is crossing of neurons when they exit from the brain. So if the right side of brain is affected, we will have paralysis of left side, left upper limb and left lower limb. And if left side of the brain is affected, then we will have paralysis of right side. So it is most common cause of severe physical disability. Incidence and prevalence of stroke is on the rise in nowadays due to increasing adoption of unhealthy lifestyle. So if the person is having unhealthy lifestyle, sedentary lifestyle, not exercising regularly, not doing physical work, then the chances of having stroke increases. Now coming to the types of stroke, we have three main types. Ischemic strokes, where the blood supply is reduced. Hemorrhagic stroke, where the blood vessel ruptures. And transient ischemic attacks, also referred to as mini stroke. The word transient, we all know, means temporary. So the blood supply will be briefly blocked or reduced to the brain for some time. Now in this diagram, it will become more clear that blood clot stops the flow of blood to an area of the brain. So we all can see here that this blood clot, it has blocked the artery, and the blood will not be able to travel ahead. So this type of stroke is known as ischemic stroke. Now coming to hemorrhagic stroke, weakened or diseased blood vessels rupture. The blood vessels in the brain are minute and thin, and the diseased blood vessel whose wall is weak can rupture, and the blood will leak into the brain tissue. Here we all can see area deprived of blood. So this area of the brain which is now not receiving the blood will lose its function and will no longer do its function for some time. Obstruction blocks flow of blood to the part of brain. In hemorrhaging stroke, there will be area of bleeding, there will be internal bleeding in the brain, in this weakened vessel wall ruptures, causing bleeding in the brain. Now coming to transient ischemic attack, in this a small blood clot will block the artery or blood supply to the brain for some time. It will not be continuous, it will be a temporary. After some time, if due to increase in pressure of the blood or something like that, the clot will dissolve and the blood supply will again open up. So it will be a temporary phase known as transient ischemic attack. Now coming to little bit detail, ischemic stroke is the most common form of stroke, accounting for around 85% of stroke. So all strokes, the ischemic strokes are the most common. This type of stroke is caused by blockages or narrowing of the arteries that provide blood to the brain, resulting in ischemia, that is severely reduced blood flow. These blockages are often caused by blood clots. Clots can be caused by fatty deposits within the arteries called plaque. So as we all had seen in this diagram, so this fatty depositions, these are known as plaque, which block the artery and block the flow of blood to the particular part of brain. Hemorrhagic stroke, they are caused by arteries in the brain either leaking the blood or bursting open. The ruptures can be caused by conditions such as hypertension. If the person is having very high blood pressure, then the small blood vessels can rupture. Then due to trauma or head injury, the blood vessels can rupture and bleeding will start. If the person is taking blood thinning medications and aneurysm, if the person is taking blood thinners, aspirin or drugs, something like that, and aneurysms are nothing but dilatation in the wall of vessel due to which the weakness occurs in the blood vessel wall. The blood vessel wall becomes weak and it can rupture with small rise of blood pressure also. Now coming to hemorrhages can be of two types, intracerebral and subarachnoid. Intracerebral hemorrhage is the most common type of hemorrhagic stroke and occurs when brain tissue is flooded with blood after an artery in the brain bursts. So if the artery in the brain bursts, the blood gets collected inside the brain. Subarachnoid hemorrhage is the second type of hemorrhagic stroke and is less common. In this type of stroke, bleeding occurs in the subarachnoid space, that is the area below the covering of the brain, the area between the brain and the thin tissues that cover it. So inside the brain, if the bleeding is occurring, then it is intracerebral hemorrhage. And if it is occurring below the covering of the brain in one of the layers, then it will be known as subarachnoid hemorrhage. Now coming to the third one, that is transient ischemic attack. These are different from aforementioned kinds of stroke because the flow of blood to the brain is only briefly interrupted. The flow is interrupted for very small time. Transient ischemic attacks are similar to ischemic strokes in that they are often caused by blood clots or other debris, small particles which can block the arteries. And these must also be regarded as medical emergencies. The reasons we will see now. Because transient ischemic attacks, they serve as warning signs for future strokes and indicate that there is a partially blocked artery or clot source in the blood. So transient ischemic attacks, they serve as a warning signs for future strokes and indicate that there is a partially blocked artery or clot inside the source, inside the heart. So according to Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, over a third of people who experience transient ischemic attack can go on to have a major stroke. So one third of the people who had transient ischemic attack can have major stroke within a year. And if they don't receive any treatment, and between 10 to 15% will have a major stroke within 3 months of transient ischemic attack. So one third can have major stroke within a year if they don't receive any treatment, and between 10 to 15% persons will have a major stroke within 3 months of transient ischemic attack. So if someone near to us is experienced transient ischemic attack, we should take them to the neurologist and start treatment so that it should not turn into a major stroke. Causes of transient ischemic attack, if we see, large artery atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is nothing but a word for these plaque formations only. So if the plaque is forming in large artery like aorta or carotid artery, which is taking blood to brain, then this is large artery atherosclerosis. Cardioaortic embolism. So when this plaque, it dislodges from its point of contact to the wall and flows in the bloodstream, then it is known as embolism. So cardioaortic embolism from the heart or aorta, if the plaque travels, get dislodged and travels in the bloodstream. Then small artery occlusion can occur due to smoking also. It can lead to transient ischemic attack. High blood pressure, if the person is experiencing, then obesity is also one of the cause. High blood cholesterol levels can also lead to transient ischemic attack. Regularly drinking an excessive amount of alcohol. So if the person is alcoholic, that can also lead to transient ischemic attack. Having a type of irregular heartbeat called atrial fibrillation. So this I already told that atrial fibrillation is nothing but dysfunction in the heartbeat rhythm. The rhythm will not be there in the heartbeat. Diabetes, if it is uncontrolled, and sometimes there are some undetermined, unidentified cause which we never come to know, and they can also cause transient ischemic attack. Now coming to the main things, that what are the signs of stroke? How can we make out that the person is having stroke or brain attack? So knowing the warning signs, first one is weakness, sudden loss of strength or sudden numbness in the face, arm or leg, even if it is temporary. So if the person is having sudden loss of strength or sudden numbness in the face, arm or leg, even if it is for a short time, then also it can be a transient ischemic attack. Then trouble in speaking, sudden difficulty in speaking or understanding, or sudden confusion, even if it is temporary. Then vision problems, sudden problem with vision, headaches, sudden severe and unusual headache without any reason. If the person is having headache, then also it can be a stroke. Then dizziness, sudden loss of balance, the patient will have loss of balance, especially with any of the above signs. So loss of balance will be present either with headache or problem in the vision, weakness or trouble in speaking. Stroke happens fast and will often occur before an individual can be seen by a doctor for a proper diagnosis. So before a person can be reaches a doctor or medical person, before that only a stroke will affect the individual. So it is very much necessary to find out that the person is having stroke as early as possible. The acronym FAST is a way to remember the signs of stroke and can help identify the onset of stroke more quickly. So we can remember this acronym FAST, in which F stands for face. So we have to see, does the face look uneven? We can ask the person to smile. So if the person smiles and the one side of face is working and other side of face is not working and it is looking uneven, overall face is looking uneven, then there are chances that the person is having stroke. Now A stands for arm. Does one arm drift down? So for this, we can ask the person to raise both of their arms. So if the person is raising only one arm and the other arm he is not able to raise, then it is a sign of stroke. Then S stands for speech. Does their speech sound strange? So we can, to check this, we can ask the person to repeat a simple phrase, simple sentence, any simple sentence. Like here it is showing that the grass is green. So if some simple sentence also patient is not able to speak, then it is also a sign of stroke. Then T in FAST stands for time. If you notice any of these signs, it is time to call ambulance. So if the face is uneven, if arm is not able to lift by the person, and if the speech of the person is strange, then we have to call ambulance or medical services as early as possible. So face drooping, F in FAST. If the person tries to smile, does one side of the face droop? Arm weakness, if the person tries to raise both their arms, does one arm drift downward? Speech difficulty, if the person tries to repeat a simple phrase in their speech, is their speech slurred or strange? Then last one is time, that is time to call ambulance 108 in India. If any of these signs are observed, contact the emergency services. So we have to contact the emergency services. This is also a fast stroke rehabilitation recognition signs. Three steps: ask the person to smile and stick out the tongue, ask the person to make a complete sentence, and third thing, ask the person to raise both arms. So same thing, contact someone if the person cannot perform these three steps. Now coming to the symptoms. So stroke can occur quickly, and as such symptoms of stroke often appear suddenly without warning. Within 5 to 10 minutes, 15 minutes, the person will have all the symptoms of stroke. The main symptoms are confusion, including trouble with speaking and understanding, headache. Headache is the most prominent sign, starting sign, possibly with altered consciousness and vomiting. The patient will become semi-conscious or unconscious, or the person will also can have vomiting. Then numbness of the face, arm or leg, particularly on one side of the body. So numbness will occur on the face, arm or leg, and that will be on the one side. Trouble with seeing in both or in one or both the eyes. The person will have visual problems in one eyes or both the eyes. There will be trouble with walking, including dizziness and lack of coordination. So coordination in walking, will the person will lack that, and he can have dizziness also. In addition to the persistence of the problems listed previously, patient may also experience following. The person can also have bladder and bowel control problems. He will not be able to control urination like that. Then the person can experience depression, pain in the hands and feet, which get worse with movement. If the person tries to move the hands and feet, the pain increases, and there will be temperature changes. Paralysis or weakness on one or both the sides of the body. So if both the hemisphere of the brain are affected, which is a rare condition, we can have weakness of both the sides of body. And then trouble in controlling or expressing emotions. So these signs, they occur lately, not immediately. If the person is crying, he continues to cry for a long time, or feel depressed for a long time. And if he is smiling or happy, then he continues to be smiling for a long time. He has a trouble in controlling the emotions. Now coming to diagnosis, physical examination. First thing, a doctor will ask about the patient's symptoms and medical history. They may check blood pressure, listen to the carotid arteries in the neck, and examine the blood vessels at the back of the eyes. The doctor will do so to check for indications of clotting. So before this person can be taken for CT scan or MRI, physical examination is done to find any signs of blood clot. Then blood test. A doctor may perform blood tests in order to find out how quickly the patient's blood clots, the level of particular substances which are responsible for clotting of the blood, and whether or not the patient has an infection in the body or brain. So blood tests are done to find out all these things. Then the main investigation which is done is CT scan, which is a series of X-ray that shows hemorrhages, strokes, tumors, and other conditions within the brain. So CT scan, it is a diagnostic test which shows that there is a brain hemorrhage or there is clotting in the blood vessel, blockage is there so that the blood is not flowing, or tumor is present inside the brain. So CT scan makes all these things clear. CT scan of the brain are one of the few ways to determine which type of stroke a person had. So to determine whether the patient had a ischemic stroke, hemorrhagic or transient ischemic attack, the best diagnostic tool is CT scan. Then MRI scan. These are radio waves and magnets which create an image of the brain to detect the damaged brain tissue, that how much of the brain tissue is damaged. Then carotid ultrasound. An ultrasound scan to check blood flow of the carotid arteries and see if there is any plaque present in the carotid arteries. Then cerebral angiogram. In this, dyes are injected into the blood vessels to make them visible under X-ray in order to give a detailed view of the brain and neck arteries. So this also shows that which artery or which branch of the main artery is blocked. Echocardiogram, a detailed image of the heart is created to check for any sources of clots that could have traveled to the brain to cause a stroke. So I told you before that a clot can be formed in the heart and it gets dislodged and then travels in the bloodstream and reaches the brain and blocks the artery in the brain. So to find the source of the clot, echocardiogram is also done. Now coming to the treatment, for ischemic stroke, aspirin or blood thinners can be given in starting a carotid end arteriectomy, a procedure which is done to remove plaques from carotid artery if present. Then angioplasty, which is the same procedure which we had seen in, which we know in heart, it is done. A stent is applied and the blockage is opened. Then anticoagulant injections are given, heparin and histamine injections, which are very much beneficial if they are given in the first 24 hours of having stroke. So as soon as the person is having stroke, if we are able to shift it to medical emergency and we can find that the person is having ischemic stroke, anticoagulant injections can be given, which minimize the effect of stroke. If the person has hemorrhagic stroke, treatment can begin with drugs being often given to reduce blood pressure in the brain, overall blood pressure in the body, and to prevent seizures or epileptic attacks, and also to prevent sudden constrictions of blood vessels in the brain, which can also increase the bleeding. Then at last, if the problem is severe, the surgical treatment will be there. The person has to undergo a surgery. Surgery can be used to repair any problems with blood vessels that have led or could lead to hemorrhagic strokes. Surgeons can place small clamps at the base of aneurysms. So aneurysm, I told you, where the wall of artery is weak. A surgery can be done where a clamp is placed at the base of aneurysm or fill them with detachable coils to stop blood flow to them and prevent their rupture so that the aneurysm should not rupture and hemorrhage should not occur inside the brain. Surgery can also be used to remove arteriovenous malformations. If there are small arteriovenous malformations present and if they are not deep inside the brain, surgery can be done to remove those. Arteriovenous malformation, as you all know, there is artery and vein, both are involved in this, and there are tangled connections between arteries and veins. They mix with each other, there is tangling, and they are weaker and burst more easily than other normal blood vessels. So their chances of getting burst are more than any other blood vessels. So for aneurysm and arteriovenous malformation, the person has to undergo surgery so that he could not have stroke in future. Now coming to the treatment, strokes are life-changing events that can affect a person both physically and emotionally, temporarily or permanently. So it is a life-changing event. If it happens in the life of any person, it changes the life both physically, emotionally, in transient ischemic attack for some time, temporarily or permanently, the patient can become disabled. After a stroke, successful recovery will often involve specific rehabilitative activities. So various rehabilitation teams are involved in stroke. Speech therapy. First one is speech therapy. If the person is having problem in speech, to help with problems producing or understanding speech, practice relaxation and changing communication style with using gestures, different gestures and different tones. So speech therapists help the patient to communicate in a better way so that he can communicate to his family members, his friends in a more effective way. Physical therapy. So proudly I can say that physical therapy is the best treatment for stroke patients. Patient can take drugs and all to prevent further stroke, but to make a person independent and to make him walk again and to lead a normal life, physical therapy plays a very important role. It helps a person to relearn movement and coordination. It is important to get out and about, even if it is difficult at first. So in starting, when we start exercises with the patient, in starting the patient feels it is very much difficult, but as soon as it gets used to it, the improvement starts occurring and the person feels better. It also helps a person to improve their ability to carry out activities of daily living, and it also helps to become independent. It also helps the patient to become independent. And with my experience also, as I'm treating patients from last 13, 14 years, I can say that from if the physiotherapy is started from the first day itself after stroke, a person can be 90 to 95% or sometimes near to 100% normal within 3 to 4 months after stroke. So physiotherapy is very much essential for all the persons having stroke. Then joining a support group to help with common mental problems in stroke. The person, if he sees that I'm not able to do work with other persons are doing, the chances of going in depression are very much. So to prevent that, we can help the person to join any support group. Many find it useful to share common experiences when they see, listen to experiences of other persons who are had stroke, and they exchange information, they feel better and they feel motivated. Then support from friends and family to provide practical support and comfort, and the doctors and medical persons, they also let friends and family know what can be done to help, which is very important. So how the family and friends, they have to do exercise, or they, how the patient can be made to sit or stand. So they all must be taught so that the person recovers as fast as possible. The last thing, coming to the last thing, that is prevention. The best way to prevent a stroke is to address the underlying causes. This is best done by living healthily, which means eating a healthy diet, maintaining healthy weight, exercise regularly, not smoking, and avoiding alcohol or moderate consumption of alcohol, not excessive. Other measures which can also help to reduce the risk of stroke include keeping blood pressure under control. If the person is having hypertension, the blood pressure must be in normal limits. Then managing diabetes well, the diabetes must also be in normal limits. Treating obstructive sleep apnea. Apnea here means absence of sleep. So if the person or someone is not able to sleep properly, not able to have deep sleep, and so that can also lead to stroke. So treating that sleep disturbance in sleep also is very much important. Then we have to go for lifestyle changes. If we are having sedentary lifestyle, we have to move to active lifestyle. A healthcare provider can also help to reduce the risk of stroke through prescribing anticoagulant and antiplatelet medication. So if the person is at the risk of having stroke, he can, with all his medications, he can also take anticoagulant medications which prevent the formation of clot inside the body, and platelet, antiplatelet medication which also prevent platelet aggregation so that the clot must not form. In addition to this, if the person has repeated strokes, the arterial surgery previously mentioned can also be done. So previously we had learned now about aneurysms and arteriovenous malformations. So if the person is having stroke one after the other and the cause is inside the structure of artery, then the person can have surgery to have stop those repeated strokes. So that's all. Thank you all for your listening.
Okay, so thank you. As I can see in the questions box that Professor Pathik Devmoulik has commented that it's a useful lecture. So one of the symptoms explained has similarity with Bell's palsy. However, if there are questions, you can post in the question box. I just shoot the poll. Professor Shantanu, should I do so?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I have put the poll. Which one is the major risk as pointed out by Dr. Shantanu? So I request all members to vote. And as always, I will be waiting for 1 minute for the votes to come. We are in the 25th second. We will wait till 1 minute. The question is major risk. Which one is the major risk? So we are in the 42nd second. So we'll wait till 1 minute. I can see around 48% votes. I request all members to vote quickly. And we will close right at 1 minute. We are 2 seconds away. So, okay, we reached 50% votes and 1 minute at the same time. I share the result with 76% said all of the above. But I don't know what you're going to give as an answer, Dr. Shantanu, but the question was major risk. So out of these three, I think it is better to point out one answer because major should mean only one, not all of the above. As per me, others may vary. So, Brother Shantanu, your comments, please.
Sir, out of these three, the major one is the high blood pressure.
Yes.
If the blood pressure shoots suddenly up above the 200 or 210, then suddenly a clots form in the body and it can block the blood supply in the brain. But actually, the three of them, all three of them were also the risk for having stroke. But the major one is the high blood pressure, because if the person is having normal blood pressure and is not having hypertension also, sometimes the blood pressure shoots up suddenly and a healthy person can also have stroke.
So because it was major, definitely all of the above is the right answer for risk factor. One is the risk factor, then definitely all three are risk factors. But because major, the word major was given, so definitely the first one is the right answer with 19% people opting for the right answer, I should say, to this question. I hide it, and I'm sure that now there will be few questions in the question panel. I will try to find those. Just a minute, please. Okay, so I start from the end. I don't find that many questions. The comment was from Professor Pratik Dev Mollik. There is a question from Mr. Sham Sundar Kaur. He's wanting to ask through mic, but still I will firstly pose the question. What are the emergency for brain stroke at home or at healthcare? Okay, so that's the question. Okay. So,
sir, it is a very much emergency condition. If you come to know the person near you is having any of the sign which we had learned today, and he is having stroke, so we should call the ambulance as soon as possible and shift the patient to the medical hospital so that he can have treatment started as early as possible to minimize the effect of stroke. So it is very much an emergency condition. It can also lead to death if the person is having hemorrhagic stroke and the bleeding inside the brain does not stop. So the person can die also. Okay, sir, one thing I want you all know that to recognize at home also that what person is having ischemic or hemorrhagic is that if the person is able to tell you that he is having headache and slowly his arm is not moving, he is feeling weakness in the arm, the chances are 90% the chances are the patient is having ischemic stroke. And if a person is sitting and suddenly becomes unconscious and he tells that there is a sharp pain in his head and he becomes unconscious, then the chances are the stroke is hemorrhagic.
Okay, so it's already 5:24. I don't know. I think Mr. Shamsundar Kaur, you got your answer. You can ask him directly over phone also, yes, because sir, it's already 5:25. Navin Garika, Mr. Navin Garika asks about the age factor. How much age factor? What age factor plays a role over here?
Sir, the most commonly we see stroke is after 45 and 50 years of age. but from last 5 to 10 years, the younger population is also started to have stroke, but the common age is above 45 to 50 years.
Okay, fine. So I will request Mr. Ramchandra Kaur to talk to him directly. Thank you. Thanks to all IEM and UEM family members, and thanks to Dr. Shantanu. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.